Benny, bring me everyone.
What do you mean everyone?
Everyone!
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
Barry Manilow know that you raid his wardrobe?
Let me explain something to you. I am not Mr. Lebowski. You're Mr. Lebowski. I'm the dude.
No one is to stone anyone until I blow this whistle.
You can't fight in here. This is the war room.
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious. And don't call me Shirley.
Lord, you can imagine where it goes from here.
Okay, well, welcome everybody. This is the Zero Game Podcast number 19, and I didn't think I would ever make it this far, but looks like I have, so you're going to have to listen to me a little bit longer. So, Satch, understand that you went to the... Where was the Star Wars celebration that you went to?
It was at the Ed Excel Centre in London.
Excel?
Yeah, Excel.
Oh, right, I didn't know it was down there. Damn, Excel?
Yeah.
Do you know what? I thought it was somewhere out of London. I had no idea it was in London.
Yeah, it was in London. It was in EdXL, man. Oh, I had no clue it was there either. I thought it was in bloody Olympia.
Right.
I actually went to Olympia first, and then I was there. I was wearing my Star Wars t-shirt. I was surrounded by all these like guys dressed up in anime. Searching for Pokemon. I was like, I don't think this is the Star Wars one. I checked my email, and it was EdXL, and I was like, oh my God. Crap.
An
hour later, I've got to EdXL and walked in. It was pretty interesting, pretty good. I didn't do the full experience. I only went for the Sunday. I didn't go for the other 2 days. I didn't camp out or anything like that. Yeah. I kind of figure I'd see like all the event stuff online and stuff and catch up with the news and stuff on there. It was a friend's birthday on Saturday. It was Kenan from, Friend Talk Film. It was his birthday, so me and Ken were out last night, so I wasn't going to do a mad night's drinking and then show up to EdXL completely off my head. And
that would have been funny.
Collapse in a queue, and then sleep in a queue, and then get the special orange wristband, and then go into the hall and stand for the whole event while, Kathleen Kennedy, talks about all these projects and stuff and not everyone, but I probably would have collapsed or snored in the middle of the, arena or some crazy thing.
Hey, so, man, you should have done that. It would have been awesome.
Yeah, I could have gone viral, but no. no, I did the sensible thing. It was good. There was lots of stuff to see, lots of props, lots of Rogue One stuff. A couple of my buddies, Simon Marrow and Neil, that's been on here as a guest quite a few times, Neil Copin. Neil queued up, Neil went, he got the wristband, he went in, he did the whole shebang. Next time he's on, we can ask him.
Yeah, we'll hear about it next time.
I'm sure we'll hear about it from him. But yeah, it was an awesome thing. I met up with him at the end of the thing. He was telling me, oh my God, it was amazing. Oh my God. Neil's our comic book guy. He goes to all conventions and stuff. So, for me, this was kind of like my first thing like this. I mean, outside of video games, me and you used to go to the ECTS show.
Yeah, when they had it.
When they used to have it over here. But that used to be a big gaming thing before, games were as big as they were now. It was, more of a low-key event.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we went when they unveiled the Game Boy Advance for the first time and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, this kind of thing was this is the first of its kind for me. I know there's a lot of film and Comic-Con kind of stuff that goes on. I should do more of these. It was a really fun time. Mm. I'm actually looking into the Comic-Con that's coming up soon, next month. I don't know whether I'll go to it, but, if I don't, I'm definitely going next year because it's just a fun thing, man.
Yeah.
They had a lot of props from Rogue One, stuff like character outfits. They had the Felicity Jones characters get up. They had, Grand Morph guys get up as well. They had a lot of stuff. Also, some two vehicles that are new to the Star Wars universe. They have a new kind of AT-AT walker that they've got unveiled there, some kind of cargo kind of thing, and they've got some new TIE Fighter, which I haven't seen in any video games or anything, but yeah.
Save that. Let's save that till we get to the topic.
Yeah, sure. But, okay.
Yeah, it's good to hear all of that stuff, though. But yeah, let's
keep it to the end.
Okay, so diving straight in, we're going to start with Rogue One. This is the trailers that, well, this isn't really a trailer, but it is a trailer. But I'm putting it in the trailer anyway. So stop whining. Jesus. So it's going to be...
Who are you talking to?
I'm talking to the audience.
Oh, okay. Yeah, stop whining. Get down.
So we're going to be the trailers that hit this week.
So the Rogue One one, it's kind of like the Episode 7 sizzle reel that they gave out.
I was just about to say.
You were trying to figure out what to call it. I call it a sizzle
reel. I was just introducing the segment.
I'll shut up. Do your thing, Joe.
So this is trailers that dropped this week or was released online this week. And we start with Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, which is a sizzle reel, as Sasha was explaining. Just continue, sir.
I can go now? It's kind of like the Episode 7 one that they showed when they didn't have any trailers as such to show the audience. This one kind of focuses, even more so like that one, that it is all practical effects. There's no CG in any of this trailer, but you know what? It's in the sizzle reel, but... You know what? It may as well have been a trailer because it looked fantastic. Anyone that felt there was a problem with reshoots or whatever for Rogue One, you know what? The footage they have right now without the reshoots look fucking amazing. Okay? So the fact they have to reshoot stuff could only be adding stuff that's going to make this thing look fucking the mutt's nuts. You know what I mean? Like, it's. I can't wait for this movie. I really can't. Like, I didn't know they filmed it in India. They filmed it in the Maldives. You have like stormtroopers walking in a clear blue ocean with lots of palm trees and stuff like that. There looks like a battle on a beach with palm trees and stuff. We knew that already from the first trailer, but they kind of go more into it here. And just everything about it just looks amazing and fresh, what you want from the Star Wars universe. I mean, like that planet, I don't know what planet it is, but you know... It's a new planet that looks like really different than anything we've ever seen on Star Wars. And plus, you know, for everything new, we've still got that little bit old. You've got the Yavin 4 base. You can see it from, you know, in a segment at for the Rogue One conference, Gareth Edwards was saying that he wanted to show the base from another angle to know people would get it. A bit more, you know, that oh, this is the same base and stuff, and they did a lot of stuff into the layout of the shots to make it like look like episode four, but you know, the original Star Wars, but kind of like, you know, modernize it, yet at the same time retaining the feel, if that makes sense. It just looks amazing, the attention to detail. You have like, I don't know whether this guy has a main part in the movie, but they have like a dude in this sizzle reel that looks like General Dodona. That's the guy that's the general in A New Hope towards the end. He like welcomes Princess Leia. He tells everyone about the attack on the Death Star. You know, he's the guy giving the mission briefing, going, guys, blah, blah, blah. We got to bomb this bit here. Done. You know, he's there in the background, and whichever actor they got, they like cloned the old guy or whatever. They got someone that fit the build. I don't know whether it's just an extra that looks like him or whether he has a part, but me as a Star Wars fanboy, I was like, whoa, that's the old dude from that one. Just little stuff like that, man. Gareth Edwards has it right here. I didn't like totally love Godzilla, but I like monsters, and you know, I'm. What I'm seeing out of Rogue One just looks fantastic, and I'm there, man.
Going from that, it seems like you liked it.
Yeah, man. It's a good
time. Am I right in saying that you liked it?
It's a good time to be a Star Wars fan. Seriously, if you're upset being a Star Wars fan, seek help or just find new stuff. But trust me,
it's not everyone's jam.
It's it looks amazing to me, and I'm old school, so
anyway, what I'm saying, it's not everyone's jam, and they can understand that. But at first I was very lukewarm about this.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah,
I watched the trailer and I thought, hey, that looks like episode 4, and that's all I felt about it.
Yeah.
This sizzle reel has done a lot more for me than that last trailer did for me. I can honestly say that I'm more fascinated by what I've seen now from that. I mean, everyone was creaming over that. excuse my tone of language there, but everyone was creaming about that Rogue One trailer, and I thought it was okay. It's better than most trailers, but I think I was just a bit used to something a little bit more different from a Star Wars trailer. But this is a real. If the trailers that succeed this aren't as good as this sizzle reel, it won't bother me, because I'm already, I think the sizzle reel has done enough for me to wow, I need to see this. This looks different enough from the Star Wars films that I'm invested in going to watch it, and I'll be getting a different part of something that a mythology that I didn't particularly know about. And so that's the saving grace for this trailer is a saving grace for me in terms of wanting to go and see the film. And so I'm down with it. I'm down with it, but I'm more excited for this than I was before. And so with that it has my vote. So okay, well, on to the next trailer, and that is La La Land, and
La La Land.
Yeah, that's the one. And La La Land is it's a film directed by Damien Chazelle, and it stars Emma Stone and Ryan Gosling. This is like a musical. It's that there's not much to be said in the trailer apart from a very succession. It has. Okay, so the imagery in this trailer is very, how can I say, always 1960s, it's got a 1960s feel to it, almost like, what's that film called, the one where they're all dancing on the street, and,
Singing in the Rain?
No, not that one. West Side Story.
West Side Story.
That's okay. A 1950s film, but, it has that feel to it, to a degree, that it's, It feels like a musical. There's not much to be said to it. It's got really nice visuals. There's no dialogue in this, and so there's not really much to be said about it apart from that it looks this is a looker trailer as opposed to a talky trailer, and there was a quick glimpse of what's his name? There's another musician in this. That wasn't Common. It was What is his name? John Legend. John Legend is in this as well. You see a very quick glimpse of him. So this is clearly going to be on the music side of things. But yeah, it looks visually stunning. I'm not really into musicals, but I'm prone to see something that's entertaining, and this looks entertaining to me. So yeah, what do you think?
I actually don't mind musicals. I mean, to be honest, I'm like. Glee was a guilty pleasure of mine. I quite like that whole TV show. And, I've seen, other musicals, like Singing in the Rain, Grease, Chicago and stuff like that. They're not theatre. I'm not that refined, but, I mean, the movie versions and stuff. But what intrigues me is director Whiplash. Love that movie. That was one of my best movies of, was it last year or was it the year before?
Last year.
It was last year. Fantastic movie. If you haven't seen Whiplash, check Whiplash. More importantly, if you're the kind of person that's artistic in any shape or form, it's a movie that'll speak to you. You know what I mean? Like, you don't have to know about Whiplash. You don't have the song Whiplash, which isn't what the movie's about, but plays a big role in the movie. I actually didn't know it was a song. I didn't know it was a song. I didn't know it was referencing the song. But, that song plays a character, and I've got that song in my head because of that movie. I didn't even know what it was before. But my point of the matter is, what's his name? Damien Chazelle?
Yeah. Chazelle.
Okay. Whiplash, fantastic movie. This is follow-up debut. He's only ever done Whiplash. He did a short film also called Whiplash, which also starred A.K. Simmons. Funnily enough, A.K. Simmons is in this movie as well.
J.K.
Simmons. What did I say?
A.K.
A.K. Who am I getting mixed up with?
A.K. I can't forget.
I'm getting mixed up with someone else. I don't know who. But anyway, J.K. He's back in this one with this director. They obviously have some kind of like to and fro and a chemistry, so that's cool. Really looking forward to it. The trailer had some really interesting visuals. It had me intrigued. I like the cast. Gosling and Emma Stone can do no wrong for me.
About Monster Squad, not Monster Squad, Gangster Squad.
No, I. You know what? That's a bad movie, but I liked it. I'm not gonna lie, I liked it. I enjoyed it. I thought, fair enough. Like it was what it was. I mean, it definitely didn't know what tone it was going for.
It was laughable towards the end,
and it was laughable before the end. But I think I had a lot of jokes in that movie. They may have been unintentional, but you know, I still enjoyed it for what it was. I saw that with Leo. Actually, he did not go to his. To his friend Pablo, what's his name? I can't remember. Mr. Palaches, that's his name. Mr. Palaches did not sort out Leo that time. He actually paid to see a movie that time. And we both liked it.
Okay. From La La Land to Kickboxer Vengeance. I can't even say it with a straight face.
Vengeance.
Okay, so Kickboxer Vengeance apparently was supposed to be a follow-up to the Kickboxer series, but turned into...
No, it was supposed to be a reboot.
Or that. And is now gracing our screens as a sequel to the Kickboxer franchise.
Yay!
And it stars Jean-Claude Van Damme, Dave Bautista, and Gina Carano. And all I can say about the trailer is that it's very paint by numbers. You've got a guy that has a brother who both do martial arts. One enters this dangerous tournament, gets killed, vows for revenge, goes to Jean-Claude Van Damme. I don't know.
Well, here's the thing, Joe. What did you expect from Kickboxer Vengeance? It's the exact same as the first one.
Yeah.
Hell, this was originally a reboot. Hell, it's the same story as the first one. The difference is, change young Jean-Claude Van Damme into a new guy, and old master is now Jean-Claude Van Damme. You know what? I'm looking forward to this. Okay? Look, this movie is nothing more, nothing less than what it is. And you know what? It knows its audience. It knows, you know what? It knows who they're going for. Quite clearly, they're not doing anything fancy with the trailer and stuff. Although I will say the trailer does look like something from the early 2000s, late 90s. It's got that thing going for it. It's a bad trailer, but you know what? I'm still sold just on the fact that like it's coming out. It's got Van Damme in. I know me and Leo are gonna like totally lap this up. Okay, because this is like one of Leo's favorite films of all time. Well, it's got his favourite person of all time, Van Damme, but like, you know, like, look, will there be that crazy dance scene in the bar, you know, he does some, can you remember that?
No.
Never seen
I've seen Kickboxer, okay, but I never liked it.
Well, Kickboxer is the ultimate cheesy 80s kung fu flick ever, okay, and... You know what, I'm not expecting this to, like, push the envelope here. I just want it just to be as good as the original, okay? I'm glad they didn't reboot it, because when they said they were rebooting it, I was like, really? Do you have to reboot Kickboxer? I mean, like, to be fair, they could probably make a better reboot out of Kickboxer, but, you know, when whoever they got as the mentor passed on doing it, I think he just decided he didn't want to do it anymore because he was locked. They went for Van Damme and they got Van Damme. And like, you know, it's now not... Now we're not going to get the horde of people that like the Ghostbusters situation go, why are you remaking Kickboxer? Because there were people that were doing that. And maybe not to the same vocal, you know, vocal lens as fucking Ghostbusters there. But like, most definitely, you know, people were angry. But now that Van Damme's in there and it's now a sequel... Yeah, I'll watch the shit out of this. I'm sorry. If it's kung fu, if it's lots of cheese, I'm there. It's a standard. It just needs to have just as much jokes in it to complement the violence. And Batista looks great. Well, he just looks like how he does in WWE, as he said to me earlier. But you know what? Sold. I want to see this.
Cool.
Well, that's just me.
I've got nothing to say about this, so yeah, cool. on to the next trailer, and that is White Girl. White Girl is the next trailer we are looking at, and okay, and so in this trailer, again, it's one of those, it's just like La La Land, it's just full of imagery, and it looks like this girl comes to this city, and not sure what the city is. I'm guessing it's Los Angeles or...
In the city.
Or, I can't, it's somewhere in America, and she's clearly got into the wrong crowd. She falls for some guy and gets her into drugs, and then she starts taking harder drugs, and she starts getting into his world. It looks like it just goes, it takes a downward spiral from there on. Just with the imagery, it's quite graphic. She's having sex with multiple dudes, multiple women. It looks grim, but it looks like a really interesting, gripping film. I can't say any more than that because there wasn't much. There's not much to take from the visuals other than that it's a girl that comes to a city her life spirals out of control, and then she ends up with the wrong crowd, and I guess that's, we'll have to watch the film to see where the story progresses. But in terms of what they've done with the imagery, it really hooks you. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to this, Satch.
But what did I get from this? I got, in the city, there's this white girl. She comes to town and associates herself with drug dealers. Her life takes a spin. She must fight to survive by making cupcakes. I don't know. It looked interesting. It looked interesting enough. They don't make these kind of gritty kind of... Well, they do, but those kind of films aren't advertised enough. But I mean, like, it kind of reminded me of stuff like Kids and... what's that one that Darren Aronofsky did with... It's his second film that he did after Pie, and it basically, I usually call it Don't Do Drugs. What's it called? Fuck.
Requiem for a Dream.
Okay.
Oh, it doesn't look as disturbing as that.
It looks like it's on that level as this and bloody Irreversible, mate. That's what I got from this. So I was like, wow, they haven't done a film like Irreversible and stuff in a while, man. I could totally dig this, but feel like really disgusted. Looks interesting. Looks like it's going to be very controversial. Could be controversial. We don't know yet. It hasn't come out yet. I thought Spring Breakers would be that movie a while back, but it really wasn't. But it was still fun.
Do you know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of Nymphomaniac.
Yeah, I could see what you mean.
It's just
yeah.
With all the visuals. The trailer had the same kind of visual traits as Nymphomaniac. And yeah. So, therefore, from the amount of sex she's having with people in there, I wouldn't be surprised if it's anything close to it. Yeah. But I don't think it will be as graphic as Nymphomaniac, but yeah.
Looks interesting. I'm not going to lie, it didn't make me go, oh, I need to see this. This looked amazing.
Well, it's not that type of film. It's a drama.
I guess maybe we'll see. I'll tell you what, it's now on my radar, so I might just check it out. Just to see what the deal is.
Well, this film's directed by Elizabeth Wood.
She did Wade in the Water Children. She's done a load of short films, you know, before all that or in between all of that. So this is kind of like a big breakout kind of thing. I'm not too sure if either cast star. They seem relatively unknown to me, but... I know, I've not, maybe they're like in TV and stuff, I haven't really done my research on them, but
The documentary, you just said it's Children Wade in Water.
Children Wade in Water.
In the water, yeah.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
But again, she's fairly new. to the game. And well, either way, it looks like it's going to be a striking film. It has very good imagery in it. So yeah, I'm like, that's one to look out for if you're into those type of films. And so yeah, look out for it. Okay, so on from the trailers to the news topics. And so the first topic today is The Founder, and Michael Keaton. This is a Michael Keaton film about the McDonald's chief and how he brought McDonald's to a small restaurant to what it is today. And it looks like the Weinstein brothers are moving this film to December to bank it for a Oscar nom, possibly. Or bank him for an Oscar nom, who knows. But if you move a film like this to December and it's got Michael Keaton in it, it looks like, and because of his buzz from the last film he did, what was the last film? Oh my gosh.
It wasn't Birdman, it was the newspaper one.
That's right. I can't remember what it's called there. Either way, it looks like they're getting this up. They're pushing this for an Oscar. Mm. So the Weinsteins clearly have faith in this. And if you know anything about the Weinstein brothers, they're a force to be reckoned with. Just look at any Kevin Smith live talk, and he talks about the Weinstein brothers like they're this entity. So yeah, they're a force to be reckoned with. And so this bodes well for the film. I'm looking forward to it. I never thought I'd be looking forward to a film about McDonald's, but it looks good. It just looks good. And now that they've moved it to December, I'm even more intrigued to know what where this film goes with that. And so yeah, I'm looking forward to it. What about you, Seth?
Yeah, totally. I remember us talking about this one a while back, a few episodes back. It was a really good trailer. But it doesn't surprise me that they've moved it for the Oscar. I mean, like, Michael Keaton is now an Oscar, you know, he's choosing the right roles. He's totally he's now that go-to guy for those kind of films. He's getting the pick of the bunch at the moment. And what I like about Michael Keaton is that he does what he wants to do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, even when he quit acting for a bit and he took some stuff just for the money or whatnot, he was always great in them. You know what I mean? Like, Need for Speed. That was a rubbish movie. It was only good for the car chases and the stunts and Michael Keaton.
I didn't even know he was in there.
Yeah, he was in that. He was just supporting. You know what I mean? He just pops up randomly. But yeah, no, doesn't surprise me they moved it. He's probably going to go for the Oscar again. He's probably pulled out yet another Oscar-worthy performance in there as well. So, you know, it's a good way to follow up, you know, his most recent success with Whiplash and the Mark Ruffalo one. What was it called now? Give me a sec.
Mark Ruffalo? Oh gosh, I know what film we're talking about as well.
Yeah, I know, it's on the tip of my tongue, but Spotlight.
Spotlight, yeah.
Spotlight, that was it.
Okay.
So, you know, it's no surprise, Michael Keaton is in the spotlight for these roles. But yeah, that's my two cents on the whole matter, really. I mean, like, they've just moved the date, makes sense.
I can't see any other Oscar. Well, when we get to the end of the year, I'm sure we'll tally up what's Oscar worthy from the whole year. But at the moment, I can't even think of anything that's got a buzz on it. Maybe Birth of a Nation, which I'm pretty sure because of its what it's dealing with will be up there. So yeah, again, I can't see any fault with this. The Weinstein brothers always know what they're doing with their properties, and so yeah. More power to it. Onto the next topic from The Founder onto Power Rangers, and so okay. So with Power Rangers, they've just unveiled some new posters with the new cast of this 2017 film. And Yeah, they look exactly how I expect them to look like. They look young and beautiful teenagers, or 20-year-olds acting as teenagers.
Ooh.
And yeah, it, I mean, they've got this guy called Zach, who's a Oriental gentleman as a or Asian in America as the Black Ranger. I can't remember.
Billy.
Trini. As the Yellow Ranger, you've got this guy called Jason as the Red Ranger, Kimberly as the Pink Ranger, and Billy as the Blue Ranger. And yeah, I mean, it's very iconic. It's got they've got the what do you call it, the lightning bolts across their faces, in the form of light on coming just going over their faces. It exposes most of their eyes and their lips and their mouth. And yeah, they're pretty cool posters for what Power Rangers is. I mean, Power Rangers doesn't really mean much to me, but to people that grew up with it in their era, I'm sure. I think the way they're going with this is more of a straight cut and less of a slapstick kind of Power Rangers.
Mm.
And so, who knows? When the first trailer hits, I'm sure we'll see what this is more about, as opposed to what the Saturday morning TV show was. And so, yeah, either way, the presentation looks good. What about you, Serge? What do you think?
Yeah, I'm not digging it. Just looks like, hey, the Flash, Team Flash. I don't know, with the Thunderbolt. I don't know. Wasn't Billy the white guy with glasses? Anyway, that's neither here nor there, because, like, I see what Zach was, the black one. They've made him Oriental. Billy's now black. That's not neither here nor there, because it's a reboot, but that was what confused me at first. I was like, you know, because of the show and stuff. Like, okay, cool. But these posters don't really do anything for me. I mean, I think I said my piece on Power Rangers. I just don't see a realistic reboot, like, working. Power Rangers, to me, the cheapness in that is what makes that show. It's a show that still goes on today in the same way, aimed at kids. But the only way to do a reboot, and the only reason why you do a reboot, is to pimp it to a mass audience that don't necessarily know what Power Rangers is. And I don't think Power Rangers needs to be this, and I don't think it will gain that audience. I have no faith in this realistic tone of Power Rangers. I'm sorry, it just, one, it doesn't work for me personally, okay, because I you know, the Saturday morning cartoon is a ridiculous idea, but it knows it's a ridiculous idea, and it's cheap and stuff because it's a ridiculous idea.
TV show, not cartoon.
TV show, whatever, you know what I mean? But you're trying to add realism to it. You're trying to make it dark and brooding and, like, you know what I mean? Trying to replicate the stuff that DC and Marvel are trying to do now.
But I haven't seen any evidence of that.
I don't know.
I've seen Rita Repulsa, and she looks different. And
she looks like a drag queen.
Well,
she looked like, she looks like an 80s drag queen.
Come on, man. You saw what she looked like in the TV show.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And that goes without saying, you know, she looked like some big pumpkin woman. But at the same time, they could have done something like made her look like something out of Star Wars. You know what I mean? Like a sand person kind of thing. I don't know. I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm just not digging this. Until I see a trailer that actually drops and shows me something on some grand scale where I'm like, whoa. And more importantly, where the hell is Tommy the Green Ranger? He's my favourite. And he ain't there. What the F? I want my I want that. I want the flute.
How do you know that's not in it?
Well,
why would it, if, from what I remember, the Green Ranger was this special guy.
No, he was the bad guy, and then he turned good, and then he saved them all.
Well, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
Why would you put them on the poster as well?
I guess. I guess. But I don't know, man. I don't know. I'm just not digging Power Rangers. I don't know. I need to see more. These posters don't really cut it for me. I think they look shit. When I saw it, I just thought, whoa, someone saw the Flash and decided to. And I get why they went with Thunderbolt, because that's the logo, before anyone gets all mad and like go, this is the logo. But I just don't see it.
Okay, but in terms of what they're doing with the posters, they just want to show the audience that will come to see this what they look like.
Yeah.
And so I get it from that standpoint.
Oh yeah, definitely.
But going from what you're saying, I mean, again, I never was really into it. I just those guys.
You know what? Again, I wouldn't know how to market this. Does that make sense? I wouldn't know how to market this to the fanboys. But then you got to understand, most of the fans are like 30 now or 25, between 25 and 30, especially this generation of Power Rangers. Yeah, they're probably 30, 29, 30, 35, 36 maybe. You know what I mean? That's a grey area. You know what I mean? So, like, I honestly wouldn't know. I just see it as a nightmare because I can't see it. Like you know what the best Power Rangers thing that came out recently? And no, it's not the Adi Shankar realistic short that came out. A lot of people are going to say that. For me, it was that Cookie Monster sketch. You ever see that?
Yeah, I've seen it.
Alright, because that was so ridiculous, so in tune with what Power Rangers was, but at the same time, violent as hell for jokes. You know what I mean? Yeah. It went the other way with it. You know what I mean? You know what? I'd watch Seth Rogen and fucking Dave Franco's Power Rangers. I want to see that version of Power Rangers. I kind of figure if you're going to do Power Rangers and have it be ridiculous, you do it as an R-rated comedy and it'd be gold. It would be gold.
On a side note, speaking of Seth Rogen, have you seen The Preacher yet?
No, I don't want to see Preacher. I want to see I want to wait till the first season is done.
Mm-hmm.
Have certain people tell me, and I say certain people, I mean people that've read the comic book and know what the fuck they're talking about, tell me that it's safe, and then I'll watch Preacher season one. Now I hear it's good. I hear it's real good. I've even heard this from people that are fanboys of the comics. But you guys, like any Preacher fans out there, you guys know what I'm talking about. Okay, they go one step wrong with this, fuck that show. All right, fuck that show.
It's doing pretty well and so far. It's already got season two greenlit.
That's great. But seriously, the one mistread with Preacher, meh, out. Literally out.
Again, so got season I'm waiting, two green light off. This is off Amazon show.
Yeah, so yeah.
If it's been greenlit, then
I understand that, but that doesn't mean look okay. Arrow and Chums was a show which was going okay for people that were into Arrow, and then season three happened and they tripped.
Do you think Seth Rogen would allow that to happen?
I don't know. I don't know him personally.
No, but I'm just saying.
I would like to think that he wouldn't. But at the same time, anything can happen. You know what I mean? Anything can happen. Just because the ball's in his court now, something could happen where he's no longer the producer of the show and someone else is. A bit like the Frank Darabont situation over at The Walking Dead.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And, you know, I haven't read The Walking Dead and I don't read the comic books of that. So I can't really have an opinion on The Walking Dead. Full stop. But I know Preacher and I'm a fan of Preacher. So it's kind of like the version that I want is the comic book. And I remember when they were saying they were making a movie version, I really didn't want it to happen.
Mm-hmm.
When I heard it was a TV show, I was like, well, that could kind of work. But again, this is like a cult book where the fans are very passionate about it. So far, my buddies are like, no, seriously, it's good. It's the shit. It's exactly what, you know, what it should be. Arseface is up in there. Cassidy is up in there. That's cool, man. But I just feel, you know, I'm just going to wait to season's done, and then I'll check it out.
Anyway. Cool, man. Cool. Well, going back to Power Rangers, you can find the posters online. If you the posters, you can see the posters everywhere. But if not, they're on the Zudo's Gang website, and you can have a look at them there, or just go to the Power Rangers Twitter page, and you'll find them. Okay, so the next topic is King Arthur. King Arthur. This is Guy Ritchie's King Arthur, and we've got some images that have been put online by Entertainment Weekly, and it just shows two images. One with Jude Law stretching his hand out like he's about to crush someone.
This is Darth Vader.
It's what?
This is Darth Vader. He's just force pushed someone, or he's just he's like, bring me the plans now.
Do you know what he looks like? Do you remember Gladiator when he does that?
Oh, yeah.
And goes like, thumbs up and that. Thumbs down.
I like my version.
Fair enough. But without equating this to a Star Wars film, he looks pretty badass.
He looks fucking miserable, though.
Yeah, well, I'm guessing he's not playing a good guy, quite clearly.
Well, King Arthur?
I don't think he's King Arthur.
Is he not?
I don't think he's King Arthur, man.
Oh, okay. Well, who's the other guy looking like he's Christian Bale out of Batman Begins?
I think that's King Arthur.
Oh, is that King Arthur?
Yeah.
Oh, so he looks straight out of Batman Begins. He looked like he's just found the League of Shadows there.
Yeah,
so that's what those bitches say to me.
Well, yeah. Okay, let me just get my story straight here.
But it definitely looks like a Guy Ritchie shot. Thing. I mean, like, the colour palette is kind of, you know, dark in tone and stuff, with lots of blues and lots of greys and stuff. I don't know, man. Guy Ritchie, he's...
Yeah, there's Charlie Hunnam, that he is King of.
Okay, he's interesting. I mean, like, here's the thing, okay. I love... My favourite Guy Ritchie film of all time is a flip coin between Lock, Stock and Two Smoking Barrels and Snatch, his debut films, okay. After that, he's had a real interesting career, okay? Like, a real fucking interesting career. Being, he's had a lot of what the fuck movies, some real dog shit movies, like, Swept Away. Sorry, Madonna, you were fucking atrocious. And I'm pretty sure Guy Ritchie, she says that himself, too. But, no, seriously, I like The Man from U.N.C.L.E., though. I think that was really underrated. No one saw it, though. But he's been trying to do this King Arthur thing for quite a while now.
Yeah, he's been trying to do it for years.
I think Warner Brothers have waited for the stink of the last King Arthur, the Clive Owen one.
I don't think anyone really remembers that either.
Yeah, well, that was bad. That was real bad. That was another one of Disney trying to, like, well, we haven't got Star Wars, but we're going to, like, turn this into some kind of mythical kind of big franchise thing. And it flopped and failed. But no, this... You know, this is a passion project for him. He's obviously trying to franchise this into a bigger thing, because when I did read about this, like, years ago...
Yeah, they want to do multiple parts of this.
Exactly. They want to do multiple parts of this, being, like, The Legend of King Arthur and stuff. Maybe go into a lot of, like, those books that are out there that follows, like, Arthurian legends and stuff. Like, The Lady in the Lake and all of that kind of stuff. I'll give it a go. Because I think it's been a long time since we've had a good King Arthur kind of sword in the
Yeah, since thing. The 80s.
Yeah. Since Excalibur?
Yeah, Excalibur, yeah. I would say that's... I have good memories of Excalibur. I'm probably wrong, but I know John Schnepp really loves that film.
Wasn't Liam Neeson in that?
I can't say if that was right or not.
For some reason, I think Liam Neeson was in that. I don't know. I can't remember.
You could be right.
I could be. But yeah, it's just been a real long time since...
Helen Mirren's in it.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me. is he?
No.
No? No. Okay.
No. Yeah, no, he is.
Oh, Liam he is. Neeson, there we go. I remembered him being in there.
Damn, Liam Neeson.
Neeson. See, Excalibur. Yeah, go Guy. Go Guy. I hope it works out for you.
Well, I mean, the from the imagery, it looks... It looks like it's going... It looks like the film I expected it to be in terms of its imagery, but...
Well, it kind of looks like winter is coming there, but... I'm sorry, just the colour palette that he uses. I just think...
Blues and greens and...
Yeah.
This is grungy blues and greens and washed out.
Yeah. Guy Ritchie is a film director that, yeah, he's had a up and down career, but you know what? He's one of those guys, when he gets it right, he gets it fucking right. He really does. Like, I like the first Sherlock Holmes. I never saw the second one.
I like the second one. The second one's really good, yeah. I like what they did with Moriarty more than what they did with him in the TV show.
Oh, really? Okay.
What they did with him in the TV show is ridiculous.
But, yeah, like, Man from U.N.C.L.E. was so underrated. I really enjoyed that film. I felt, Rock and Roller was kind of a step in the right direction from...
I loved Rock and Roller,
yeah,
man.
Rock and Roller was cool.
That was almost like Snatch to me.
Yeah, exactly. Whenever I watch Lock, Stock and Two Smoking Barrels and Snatch, it's like a treat.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't watch them consistently, but there was a point where they were the most quotable films in England.
Yeah.
Like, in the UK. Okay, this is for anyone in the UK. Around the age of 30, 40 and 30?
No, I'd say around our age.
Around our age?
Yeah, that's why
I gave it the 10-year 30 to 40.
Oh, okay, fair enough. Yeah.
It was quotable as hell, man, and both of those films. And they're really good films. If you haven't seen them, anyone that watches the show or listens to the show in the US, check them. Check Snatch. Snatch is great. It's got Brad Pitt and Benicio Del Toro in it. It's fantastic.
King Arthur.
I want to see a trailer. Let's see what he does.
I'm guessing this would be the first type of film like this he's done, right?
I think this is the first period piece he's done.
So this will be interesting.
You count the Sherlock films, they're period pieces, but this is probably the first kind of epic, you know, like Gladiator kind of, Game of Thrones, Lord of the Rings kind of scale, Bravehearty kind of thingamajig. You know what I mean? But I don't recall him doing...
No, I don't think he has. So this will be interesting to see especially the trailer, what the trailer will look like in terms of how he presents it to the audience. Because I'm guessing it's going to be Ridley Scott-esque in the way he presents it. And so I'm looking forward to the trailer. So.
Is Vinny Jones in it?
No, not that I know of, no.
Yeah. Well, as long as it's nothing like Revolver or Swept Away, but yeah, should be good.
I kind of like Revolver.
Really?
Yeah, it reminded me of this game called Killer 7. It's... multiple personalities. You really don't know what's going on up until the sort of the end. But it's not his best film, and it's definitely not for everyone. But I saw what he was trying to do, but I guess the execution just wasn't that great. But so that's Excalibur. Look out for that. We'll have more news on that very soon. Okay, on to the next topic, and that's a Pokemon movie. And so if you guys aren't aware, and I'm sure you are by now, there's this thing called Pokemon Go that swapped the world by storm, and
it's going viral all over RedTube. Pokemon gotta snatch them all.
Oh boy. this isn't that kind of podcast, so ignore him.
Sorry.
Yes. As far as I'm concerned, I've known about Pokemon since I was 15, because that's when it came out. The first Pokemon, Red and Blue. I was in high school when it came out, and so...
Was it Red and Blue? Yeah, it was Red and Blue.
Yeah.
I can't remember.
Fair enough. I remember... In fact, I was just leaving high school, or was I just in college? I was either in college or high school, either way. I remember that being the thing. It was after Tamagotchis, you had Pokemon, and then Pokemon just stayed. It just stayed and stayed and stayed. And Nintendo knew what they were doing with that on that front, and so this phenomenon has. It's not really a phenomenon to me. It seems to be a phenomenon for a lot of other people, because oh my god, Pokemon, what's this? What's that? And there's a lot of people my age saying that, oh, it's for kids, but it's just a game, essentially. It's It's not for any demographics, for everyone. And so the way I saw it was, oh, okay, this is back. And it's just adults are playing it now. Just like adults played Tetris and played Super Mario Brothers or Mario Kart. There was no difference in demographic to in terms of who played and who doesn't play. Either way, looks like, I'm not sure what the company is, but they, looks like someone wants to make a film out of this, and all it is for Nintendo to play ball, really, because if they capitalize on this quickly, they can take... I don't know how you would film anything like this or market it, but it seems that whatever Nintendo are doing is they're doing it well, and if anything, a film sooner or later would be great to see in the works. And so, Satch, on to you.
Well, I never really followed it. Like, it was really big for my little brother. But I acknowledge, look, it's no surprise the app did as well as it did for me, because you got to understand that
I'm surprised.
Spanned, no, but here's the thing, it spanned a generation, a whole generation of gamers that grew up with it in primary school, middle school, high school, whenever they got the bug in, you know, I'd say a good 10-year radius there of gamers that have gotten into it. And Nintendo keep bringing out iterations of it every console generation.
I think, you know, even more than that.
Well, probably more than that, but either way, there's different iterations on every console, and every time, you know what, Pokemon has kept the company afloat.
No, it hasn't.
Well, to a degree it has, no, it sometimes. Hasn't. I disagree. With the 3DS, I think most definitely that was one of the reasons why, like, it stayed in power, kind of thing. Along with other games as well. But I mean, like, everyone knows Pokemon, and everyone knows you only get Pokemon on Nintendo. You know what I mean? And that's probably why Nintendo were like, you know, the old guard were afraid of putting it on the phone, because they didn't want to make their machines absolute. They haven't done that because, you know, enough gamers buy a 3DS anyway to, you know, warrant them making one. But the point I'm trying to make is there's a demand for Pokemon, and when it went on all the platforms of mobile phone platforms, it was no surprise to me that it was going to be a big success and that they were going to make a shit ton of money.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think anyone anticipated how much money they were going to make and how big this Pokemon Go would be.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense? We knew it was going to be big. We didn't know it was going to be this big. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Hell, I've got it. I've got the app. I've played it. I get it.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have to get the app, but I got it.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I got it. I got the idea. I got the concept. It's like, for those that don't know, okay, Pokemon's like trading cards, okay? Imagine the animal, but you collect them. You got to collect them all the different types of Pokemon. Now, here's where the Tamagotchi side of it. You got to keep them happy. You got to train them, take them to the gym and stuff, feed them right. And then they evolve and they become really big Pokemon, and then you can battle other people for their Pokemons and stuff and steal their Pokemons and et cetera, et cetera. You know what I mean? It's a game. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a strategy game. There's a little bit... You know what I mean? They've just... Rather than make a game an RPG, they've made it an actual active thing where it requires the user to go to places.
Mm-hmm.
And that's genius, because it's making people socialize and meet each other and stuff. Some cases, some parents could say, oh, that's a bad thing because anyone could do that and I've got my child. Well, that's why on the loading screen it says, look after your damn kids. You know what I mean? It's not up to Nintendo to look after your kids. You know what I mean? That's common fucking sense. They also put a disclaimer saying, be aware of your surroundings. You know what else is common fucking sense? There's also common fucking sense. So I just have to nitpick on certain reasons people attack this game. In terms of back to the main topic, the movie, is it a surprise? No, not at all. I don't see them... you know what I mean? I could picture them making a Pokemon movie. Would it be something that I'd want to watch? Not necessarily, not really my thing.
If it's done by the Lego guys, I'll watch it.
Oh, yeah. If it's done by, if it's by Lord and Miller, Miller, definitely. Definitely, because it would depend on the team, etc. But when I hear it straight away, all of a sudden I feel, I think Garfield. Does that make sense?
Wow, it shouldn't be that bad.
I actually didn't think Garfield was that bad.
Well, well, okay.
The first one. No, it was what it was. It was aimed at kids, but I wouldn't call it an Oscar-worthy movie that everyone needs to see. It's a Sunday film or a Christmas film. It could have been better. It could have been written a lot better to get more people into it and actually have them not shit on it. But, you know, for the audience that's aimed at, I can't really say it did anything wrong. Pokemon, I'd expect the same. You know what I mean? Unless they get a great team and make a great movie and it drags. You know, like what Paddington was. Paddington, if you gave Paddington a chance, watch Paddington. Paddington the Bear, yeah, marmalade sandwiches and all of that shit. He has a fantastic movie. It's am I correct?
Yeah, I own it.
Yeah, exactly. It's a great movie.
I grew up for Paddington.
Written and made by people that got it, that got the character. I've preached till the cows come home my stance on video game movies. They're only ever going to be as good as the filmmakers that pick the material and whether they have a love for the material. So if they're to make a Pokemon movie like anything, let's stick to those rules. You know what I mean? The fact that they're talking about making one doesn't surprise me. Do I care about this movie? Maybe not necessarily, but if it came out, I'd give it a shot depending on who the talent was behind it.
Mm-hmm.
It's too premature now.
Yeah.
That's just my two cents on Pokemon Go, Pokemon the movie, Pokemon the YouTube version, and anything to do with poking and mums. And
okay, on to the next topic. It's Star Trek 4, and producer J.B. Abrams has said that... looks like he's not fast tracking the next film, but there's definitely going to be another film. And so, I guess that's no big surprise really. But and it looks like Chris Hemsworth may come back. Thor will come back to this film in some degree. I don't know how they'll do that. I'm guessing it's going to be like a Star Trek 4 kind of
time travel cloning.
I'm not sure if you saw this one. No, I don't think you did. But they did like this time travel thing in the original cast in Star Trek IV, The Voyage Home. And they went around the sun. So I'm guessing they're going to do something like that. And Kirk and his father will be side by side together in some degree. But it looks like this one that's about to come out, Star Trek Beyond, it's been directed by Justin Lin. Looks like it's about to do pretty well. It's projected to do well. And so, again, it's a no-brainer. When you go from the third film, you go to the fourth film. But will everyone be back for the fourth film, do you think? Is it going to be... they're going to recast?
They're all back. They've already stated that they're all back and they've all signed on for the next one and the fifth one, to be honest. Unfortunately, the only person that isn't coming back is Anton Yelchin. Mm. God bless him. I was thinking the other day, should they recast him?
They have to, because Chekhov is a character, is the main character. Not a main character, he's a supporting character.
Could they kill him off?
He's never been killed of any of the iterations.
So why couldn't they not kill him off? It's a reboot. It's a different timeline. They could retire him.
Is it necessary to kill him if he hasn't even started?
They could retire him. He could say Starfleet's not for him. I can't
see that happening. I think they'll recast him.
That's what I'd do. I'd write him out.
Fair enough.
Because it's an alternative timeline. You get some new guy to fill it. Everyone will get mad and stuff, but then you got to understand it's a
different timeline. I'm glad I'm not either.
It's a different timeline. And then, like, you could bring him back and recast in another one so everyone will be like, you know, like, don't kick the man while he's down. You know, they're not going to...
It's not kicking anyone while they're down. It's not like... what's his name?
Who'd you get as the new Chekhov?
Sorry?
Who would you cast as the new Chekhov?
I have no idea.
Elijah Wood?
Again, I have no idea.
Okay.
It's okay. So, like, who's the guy that died in Fast and Furious?
Paul Walker.
Paul Walker. That's you. Okay, with Paul Walker, his character was integral to that film, and if you recast him, that would be more of a disrespect. But because Chekhov has been played by multiple people now, there's no single identity to that character. The character is more important than the
old guy still alive? Is the old guy still alive?
Yeah.
Get him back. Do a time travel story and bring him back into the field, man. There, we've solved the Chekhov problem. I don't know, man. Back to the subject at hand, Star Trek 4. Sounds like this third one's going beyond expectations. They're looking forward to the success of the saga and whatnot. Chris Helmsworth, well, that's a given. You know, this is a rebooted Star Trek to get the mass audience in. Quit associating Chris Helmsworth now that he's broken out as Thor, and you know, it could work for them a lot. You know, Thor, oh, he's in Star Trek, yeah, blah blah. But then the other counterbalance of that, where are these people when he does his other movies? You know what I mean? Like, no one saw Heart of the Sea. You know what I mean? I don't think he's the pull in Ghostbusters. I think the brand name's the pull. You know what I mean?
I don't think anything is a pull in that film, what I've been hearing.
That's just it. But, no, it'll be interesting to see what they do with Star Trek. Let's see whether the new one's good first. And, yeah.
Star Trek!
Yeah. I don't know, it's the fourth one. What, was there whales in the last one?
Whales?
Yeah, whales. Wasn't there like a whale one? They went back in time, they spoke to some whales and stuff, and the whales could speak to... I don't know, I switched off when I heard about whales.
That's exactly right.
Yeah, that's why I didn't like it. No,
you're wrong.
Yeah, I was like, the whales. Change.
So you've not watched The Voyage Home?
Which one's The Voyage Home?
That's the one you're just talking about.
I watched some of it. Wasn't my bag.
That's one of my favourite ones.
Oh, okay.
So, clearly it's not your thing. So
it never was, man. I think I was 9 at the time when I tried to watch it. Yeah.
Watch it again. I think you'll enjoy it.
Probably.
It's funny. It's really funny. On from Star Trek, onto Kingsman the Golden Circle. And so there's a picture of... there was a picture taken of Colin Firth with the quote... what's the quote? Oh my gosh. It was a Mark Twain quote. Anyway, there's a picture of him online. Mm. He's back. I don't know what capacity he's back, but he's definitely in the film.
He's a robot.
No, I don't think so.
Time travel. Clones.
Clone baby. As my friend Chris Un always says, shock. I don't think it's either of those things. On Movie Talk, they were saying that it could be like they got his memory backed up on like a computer system, and you can see him in this like a danger room kind of thing, and he'll teach people or whatever.
So it is a cyborg. Well,
no, hologram. It's a Jor-El. Computer image.
It's Jor-El.
Yeah, I guess.
That's exactly what you just said. He's Jor-El. They've put him in a hologram. He's going to teach Eggsy the ways of being real good at spying and stuff. Just not in the shower rooms. he's just going to train him to be a secret agent from beyond the grave. And yeah.
Well, Colin Firth was one of the characters I really liked.
Definitely.
I didn't expect to like him that much, but that scene in the church...
Oh, the church scene was fantastic. That was just action cinematography innovation right there. I think it had some Resident Evil 4 kind of vibe to it as well.
Yeah, the camera was always over there.
Yeah, exactly.
Just and directly behind it.
It was just madness, man. I need to watch that film again. But no, you're right. Having him back in, definite plus. In what form? I think, more logically, I think they'll probably go with flashback. maybe there'll be like a odd mission of his, or maybe even like a video message that he left to Eggsy, just in case he got, you know, shot down or whatever. I don't know, man.
Whatever capacity is in the film is, I think people would just be glad to, hey, it's,
yeah, it's called
Colin Firth. Yeah. And because there's not really much to say about that, but yeah, you can find a picture on Twitter or on any website. If not, I'll put it up on my website. But have a look at it, man. It's it looks like it's going to be a fun sequel. Mm. You've got is Helen Mirren in this?
I think so.
Let's have a look, see. Kingsman.
It's got Julianne Moore.
Ah, Julianne Moore, okay.
Yeah, it wasn't Helen Mirren, it was Julianne Moore.
Channing Tatum, Julianne Moore, Jeff Bridges, Halle Berry, Colin Firth, Mark Strong, Vinnie Jones.
Elton John?
Yep, Elton John. Yeah, it's got an interesting cast, man. Mm. so either way, it's definitely going to be an entertaining film, especially with that lineup.
What? No Mark Hamill? Oh yeah, he died. That's probably why they got Jeff Bridges. He could be his bearded brother. I'm sorry, they both look the same these days.
If you say so. okay, so I'm from Kingsman to Frankenstein. Frankenstein.
Frankenstein.
Frankenstein. Okay, so it looks like Javier Bardem is been hooked to play this role. Or pointed at to play this role. It looks like he may be playing this role.
Okay.
But there's no claim to that at the moment. But from all I can say is that that whole Monsters Universe thing that Universal want to do, they're putting some proper heavyweights into it. They're not messing around with this. I mean, you've got Tom Cruise, you've got the guy you just mentioned, Jor-El.
Colin Firth.
Not Colin Firth.
Marlon Brando.
No, he's dead.
Russell Crowe.
Yes, one. Russell Crowe. And you've got, what's his name? The Pirates of the Caribbean dude.
Jerry Bruckheimer. Johnny Depp.
Johnny Depp, yeah.
Who's Johnny Depp?
I don't know, but he's in one of these. One of them.
Okay.
My point is that they're getting these, they're just getting actors, all these stellar actors, and just putting them into this Universal Monster Monster Squad thing. So to me, I don't know what type of Frankenstein it will be. I don't know if it's going to... if it's going to be the slow-moving Frankenstein, or if it's going to be the smart-thinking Frankenstein, Frankenstein's monster anyway.
Yeah. Does Del Toro have anything to do with this?
No.
Well, that's their first fail.
Well, Del Toro's doing every film in the world at the moment.
I know, so. But like that is their first fail. If anything, if this was me at Universal, this is my plans. Get Del Toro, pay him bare monies.
He's too busy.
Just pay him bare monies. Get him to be their Kevin Feige.
He's far too busy, man. Isn't he doing that one that was like Prometheus at the moment? The one Mountain.
Mountain to Madness. No.
I think so. No, he's not doing that anymore, is he?
Well, no, but I did suggest that's what I think is going to happen. Because it's an untitled project at the moment.
That's the thing. If you look on his list, he's doing like all these other projects.
Yeah, he's I know he's got a billion projects, but you know.
And so I mean, asking him to do something like that, I don't know, man.
I'm saying produce. I'm not saying direct.
Even that, I mean, even it says Hellboy 3's announced here, but.
Well, that's I don't see happening.
Not, yeah, I can't see that happening.
Yeah,
either.
I don't see that happening.
I mean, either way, Javier Bardem. He's a Oscar winner, great actor. I loved him in Vicky Cristina Barcelona and No Country for Old Men.
Yeah,
that he was brilliant in that. What do you think about? I mean, do you even like the monster movies and stuff like Frankenstein or?
Yeah.
Or
I like the old Hammer ones. Mm. Christopher Lee and.
What do you think of the Mummy film, the one with Tom Cruise at the moment?
Well, it looks interesting.
Yeah.
I need to see more than what we're getting. The fact is, it's all hearsay. Until I see a trailer and go, I like this trailer. I want to invest my dollars in a movie.
Okay,
but at the moment, it's, you got to understand, this whole monsters movie universe thing is trying to recreate the Marvel formula. Okay, that works for Marvel. That would work for DC if they followed it. Whether it works for other franchises, we don't know. It's untested. Do I agree with them that they should do this with the horror movies? Well, they did them originally back in the 50s. They had crossovers. They had Frankenstein versus, you know, Dracula and that kind of thing. And to be honest, I thought that's what we were getting before the Marvel stuff happened with Van Helsing with...
Really?
Well, yeah, because he fought bloody the Hunchback of Notre Dame, he fought the werewolf, he fought the Creature of the Blue Lagoon in the first, like, 5 minutes, and then he was fighting Dracula throughout most of the movie. So, you know, to be honest, yeah, I can remember when they showed the trailers to Van Helsing, and this is straight after The Mummy, mind you, where Stephen Sommers had kind of won us all with, like, you know, what he could do with The Mummy. So when I heard director of The Mummy... Van Helsing, I saw that original trailer, and that original trailer didn't look that bad. It looked pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you had Hugh Jackman straight off of X-Men. He looked kind of mysterious. There was talks of this being like his Indiana Jones. I liked the look of Van Helsing, and I thought, you know what, personally, I think they just should have had Van Helsing and just have him swear off a different monster every movie rather than cram them all into one movie and, like, have it be convoluted and be a shocking result of what we got. Because that movie, you know what that movie suffered from? Stephen Sommers. That's what it suffered from. It suffered from, like, he did a good job with the first Mummy. The rest of them have been dog shit. You know what I mean? His style to action directing isn't really something that I'm a fan of, because he does dumb action. You know what I mean? The kind of action where you look at it and then you question, why didn't you do this in the first place?
Mm-hmm.
I can't give you a specific scene in Van Helsing. If I remember, it had something to do with a vial. It just made no sense to me. And I was just like, I've lost interest in believability of this movie. But the fact of the matter is that this whole Monsters Universe kind of thing, I think, until I see more, then I can comment. At the moment, we'll see.
But as I was going to say, the reason why I asked you that is because you got someone like Tom Cruise. Tom Cruise doesn't say yes to just anything.
That's true. That is also very true. I mean, like, you know, Tom Cruise is probably the only reason why I'm, like, kind of intrigued.
Yeah, that's the only reason I'm intrigued.
But outside of Tom Cruise, you know, The Rock and the werewolf thing, the Wolfman thing, I like The Rock, but here's the thing. I don't go to the movies because The Rock is in it sometimes, because sometimes I just know it's a bad idea. Rock, I like you. I like The Rock as an individual, as an entertainer, but he has made some piss poor movie choices in his career. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not going to flock to him every time. Does that make sense? So The Wolfman, I'm like, yeah, sure, you're The Wolfman, but, like, is it good? You know what I mean? Tom Cruise is someone where I can be like, no, you know what? I'll give it a shot. But Universal, I don't know what they're cooking. I don't know who the main heads are behind any of these plans. You know what I mean?
Mm.
So I don't really have... Because they've stated they want to do a Marvel Universe kind of thing, you know, hence my point with Del Toro. Okay, he's got a billion projects, but let's say he didn't.
Mm-hmm.
And he was the guy, I'd have faith in it. I'd be interested. I'd be invested straight away. I'd be like... Well, Del Toro's behind it. you know what I mean? I'll buy that for a dollar because I know I'm going to get some crazy take on all of these classic monsters.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? But, you know, that's just my two cents.
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess we'll see. Once we see a trailer, for the Mummy film, which looks like it's going to be fairly, if not better than the mummies that went before it. I'm looking forward to it. So I'm looking forward to hearing more about it. I can't say I'm looking forward to it. So, yeah, I'll go with that. I'll go with that much anyway. So yeah. Okay, so on from Frankenstein onto Wonder Woman.
Wonder Woman.
And so, a few days ago, there were some pictures of Wonder Woman.
Oh, wow.
Put online. Some of them are good, some of them are bad. I can't find the bad ones at the moment, but the one that we're looking at currently, it's got her taking her sword out with her shield, ready for a pose. It's quite colourful, more of a colourful. She looks more like the Linda Carter version.
Well, I have no problem with that.
No. I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but because there's a time difference between her and this and her and Batman vs Superman, that's why she looks different. And so this one, she looks more like Linda Carter. If you don't know who Linda Carter is, Linda Carter was the original Wonder Woman from the 1970s show. If you just look online, you'll find it. And just looking at her, some people still don't like her. I think as far as I'm concerned, when I saw Batman vs Superman, she was one of the only things that held that film up in terms of, okay, I like her character. Yeah. I've never seen her character on screen before, but she sells it to me. She sold it to me really well, and so I'm looking forward to seeing more of what she can do. I was never, when I heard Gal Gadot was going to be her, I was like, what?
Yeah.
But yeah, now it makes sense. So yeah, I'm down with her. What do you think?
Yeah, I'm down with this movie. We'll see. I mean, like, Batman Superman kind of left a bad taste in my mouth. It's official. I can now trash talk this movie. It sucks. I couldn't before. I was under embargo by bloody cinemas. Bleep that cinemas bit out. Bleep it twice. I was under embargo. And, you know, now I can talk about Batman versus Superman. It was a dog shit pile of trash. It's probably the worst film I've seen all year. Officially the worst film I've seen all year, but it had plus points. The plus points were Ben Affleck's Batman and Gal Gadot. Gal Gadot as Wonder Woman, cool. Let's see the movie. I've not been following it because of how shit Batman vs Superman was. We'll see. Suicide Squad's looking quite good. This one, maybe. I know this is directed by Patty Jenkins that did Monster, so I know she's done various TV stuff. I don't know who's writing it. I just hope that what happened on Batman, Superman has kind of affected this in the positive light, where they're trying to work to make a great, you know, a better movie. Hopefully, like, they looked at what works, what doesn't work. Maybe did reshoots. I don't know, but you know, these DC films, I'm not too sure about. You know, the only ones I'm looking forward to are the latter half, where Geoff Jones is actually involved with Ben Affleck, you know? So I'm looking forward to the standalone Batman. I'm looking forward to The Flash, maybe, because The Flash is going to be a hard buy for me, because I love the TV show. All right, that's going to be the Superman Returns versus Smallville of this generation, okay? The Flash movie. Alright, and the worst thing about that movie is that there has never been a Flash movie. Does that make sense? So you don't have people that were rooting for one of nostalgia of something that came before, unlike Superman Returns, because Superman Returns was so nostalgic to the Chris Reeves original, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have that with this incarnation of the Flash. We just have the lovers of the TV show, and I am one of them. That TV show, man, that was a fantastic season two. You know, it's fantastic. And I just don't know how that's going to pan out there. In terms of Wonder Woman itself, I hope it's good. I wish them best of luck. These pictures look great. She looks great. I want to see a trailer. We'll have to see. In terms of Suicide Squad, because I know I touched on that. You know what? I have full faith in Suicide Squad, and that's down to the director. I love all of his movies. I love Sabotage. I love End of Watch. I love... what was the film he came out recently? Fury. If you haven't seen Fury, fantastic movie. Shia LaBeouf steals the show in that. Brad Pitt is awesome. Lerman Logan. Percy Jackson is fantastic in that. It's a good movie. And he's a fantastic director. Suicide Squad, at first, the pictures, I wasn't too sure of it. But the more I'm seeing of it, I'm kind of warming up to it. And I'm seeing a lot more footage in terms of what the characters are like with each other. And it's very much in vein of Sabotage. If you've ever seen his movie Sabotage, it's a good fucking Arnold Schwarzenegger movie. I don't care what anyone says. The last 5 minutes kind of ruined it for me, but that aside, I enjoyed the ride. Hopefully Suicide Squad will be like that, and that's why I'm digging Suicide Squad. I reiterate, Wonder Woman, not too sure, but, show me a trailer, I could change my tune.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that's my 2 cents on Wonder Woman.
To me, I'm not really particularly bothered about Suicide Squad. I'm not as excited about it as everyone else is, but... yeah, sure, I'll watch it. But that Batman vs. Superman left a really bad taste in my mouth. And oh boy. it's not good. To be honest, the only shining light was, as you said, Ben Affleck's Batman and Wonder Woman. Gal Gadot's Wonder Woman was okay, so the only thing bad about Batman in that film was the whole Martha incident. But beyond that, and him being very reckless, I don't blame that on Ben Affleck. I blame that on the scriptwriters and... I forgot the director. Zack Snyder. And so... I want to see more of Ben Affleck's Batman. I'm intrigued to see what he looks like in Suicide Squad, because... it's from the villain's point of view of how they view Batman, and so that's the one thing that I want to see what that looks like. Beyond that, I really don't care about any of the characters. But I'm intrigued, but not as interested in anyone else. And as far as Wonder Woman is concerned, I want to see as much as I can of her. Because I think she did a pretty good job as Wonder Woman, Gal Gadot, that is. And so, yeah, and that's that. So, yeah, we'll have more news on Wonder Woman as it comes in. And that's the end of the main the news topics. Onto the main story, which is Star Wars. You went to Star Wars Celebration today, and so you were telling us earlier in the top of the show that... everything that you saw there and everything that you expected to see. Okay, so for instance, you're saying that they showed the trailer to...
Okay, let's talk about Rogue One. Okay, aside from the sizzle reel that we talked about earlier, which I'm not going to retread, they had the panel. You can check it up on YouTube. I checked that up on YouTube because I wasn't physically there for that. Good panel. They introduced all the stars of the show. We had some Donnie Yen up in there. He was there for the first time. I was like going nuts. If you guys don't know who Donnie Yen is, look up the following films: The Iron Monkey, Ip Man 1 and 2 and 3, and various more. Just look up most of his movies and you'll get why there's a big love for this guy. He's like, probably in my opinion, he should have broken out to Hollywood a real long time ago. I've jizzed in my pants because we've got Donnie Yen in Star Wars. So, Forrest Whitaker was up in there talking more about Saul Guerrero. Everyone was talking about their characters. I do believe one of the actors, I forgot his name, he was the other Oriental dude that was next to Donnie Yen. he went into his character, his English was quite limited, but he accidentally revealed a major plot point to the whole movie, which made Gwendolyn Christie, who was the Hope, go bright red and tried to change subject really quickly, in which case he reiterated, yeah, my character has a big gun. Big gun. He has big gun. Big gun. Big gun. He realised what he'd done, and he was like, oh shit. Kathleen Kennedy did not look impressed.
Well, that's language yeah, piracy.
All I'm going to say is after Donnie Yen says his bit, the guy next to him, skip it 5 minutes, skip the panel 5 minutes, and you won't get spoiled, because it was a major spoiler.
Okay.
Man's not going to be in another Star Wars movie. Just saying.
You don't know that. You can't blame.
Maybe not. It was probably accidental. I'm sure he didn't mean it. But just the looks. Gwendolyn Christie was. She went bright red, dude. She was just like, "Yo, the NDA." Like without even saying it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It was hilarious. Rogue One was shown in full force. Gareth Edwards talked a lot about, you know, his Star Wars background and stuff. He was talking about how they filmed the film at one of the tube stations. Can't remember which tube station it was. It might have been Westminster or around that area. But he was talking about how they did a night shoot and they were filming it. And everyone was dressed up as stormtroopers and in their costumes and stuff, and they filmed everything. And when they just got the last shot, 5 minutes before the station opened, so they got rid of all the movie cameras, but all the stormtroopers were still in uniform and there, and normal commuters were just going to work. Just thinking, what's a stormtrooper doing here?
Mm-hmm.
Totally unaware that they just filmed the Star Wars movie.
Or part of one, anyway.
Yeah, or part of one. But Gareth Edwards, he said, you know, for years he thought, you know, if he, you know, he always wanted to use that particular train station for a science fiction short. He just never thought it'd be for Star Wars. So, yeah. You know, and looking at the trailer, on which this, because I remember when I first saw the trailer, I was like, why does that look familiar? And, like, anyone in London knows those train stations, because they all look kind of the same, because they're all quite modern looking and they all got like that science fiction. It kind of looks like bloody Logan's Run in there, man. But you know, I was there today on the way to Celebration, and like, yeah, man, I totally get why they picked that as a location. But yeah, he was going on about that. He was going on about his love for Star Wars, and that dude can quote A New Hope like I can quote A New Hope line for line, and he actually proved it on down in an interview that came on StarWars.com, not at Celebration, but like the day before Celebration.
Yeah.
And actually has him side by side quoting the dialogue while in another panel they're sharing the movie, and he loves his franchise. He even had like photos of when he went to Tunisia and he visited the hotel with his girlfriend that is Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru's house, kind of thing. And he was like telling the story about how he went there trying to recreate scenes from A New Hope, and this is like 10 years before he even started filming The Galaxy Far Far Away. So he's very much a fanboy. We all know, if you haven't seen Monsters, check out Monsters. I'm pretty sure a lot of you guys have seen Godzilla. Don't judge him by Godzilla, judge him by Monsters, and Monsters is fantastic. I can't wait for...
I don't think everyone will like Monsters.
True, but I think it's a great film. I think it's going to turn out to be okay, man. It's going to be very different.
In terms of what you can do with scale,
yeah.
I think we're going to see something interesting.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think we're going to get a very different kind of Star Wars movie, but something that's going to be very fanboy-esque, if that makes sense. I don't think the fans are going to be let down by this. But yeah, Rogue One looks fantastic. And my friend Simon Marrow and my friend Neil, that's been on the podcast, they both said they've seen the second trailer for Rogue One. It debuted at... They had a trailer at Celebration, and they confirmed that Darth Vader is in there in his full glory towards the end of the trailer.
Mm.
So I think the marketing of Vader is going to be pushed very heavily in the next trailer, and then from the next trailer onwards, kind of thing, Vader's presence being in the movie, which is a good thing considering like it ends seconds before New Hope begins. So very much looking forward to that movie. Other stuff they touched on about, there was the Rebels panel showing Star Wars Rebels for all you Star Wars fans. Grand Admiral Thrawn is now canon. If you don't know who Grand Admiral Thrawn is, you obviously not read Timothy Zahn Here to the Empire trilogy. Three damn books that are no longer canon but are very good books. Check them out. He's Grand Admiral Thrawn. It's always been a fan favorite. He's a blue alien with red eyes. He's an admiral. He's now canon. The fans went nuts, absolutely nuts, with his inclusion finally being recognized in the Star Wars universe, actually being played. It's the first time he's ever been in, you know, in something like a cartoon or live action series. This is a cartoon, so this is the first time he's been visualized in that medium. He's been in the games, like he was in the X-Wing game and the TIE Fighter game, but aside from those games, I don't recall him being in any other Star Wars games. But you know, yeah, man, really big news. Be interesting to see whether he actually makes it into the movies, whether it be the spin-off movies. I don't see him being in the episodes, but then you never know. You never know, because there's no reason why he couldn't, you know? To be honest, like, I think he would have been good in Force Awakens as the Admiral Hux character, personally. And people just would have been like, holy shit, is that Thrawn? You know what I mean? But then the way Dave Filoni, who's the executive producer on Rebels, he also worked with George Lucas on the Clone Wars, so Clone Wars and Rebels were like his babies. You know, he went into saying that, look, you know, for the kind of character he is, you don't want to shortchange him by just putting him in for the sake of, you know what I mean? He has to have a sense of purpose and stuff. So if we were to get him into live action movies, they're probably going to work towards him, you know, to please us, rather than just throw him in there for the sake of. Especially, and right after that, they got Timothy Zahn, the author and creator of Thrawn, that wrote the Here to the Empire trilogy, to saying that he's writing a new novel in Star Wars canon based on Thrawn and him in this new rebooted canon universe kind of thing. Because obviously, you know, the stuff that happened in Here to the Empire didn't happen. So I'd be interested to see how much of the old stuff gets ported back, you know what I mean, in that book. The book comes out in April. The fans went nuts. The trailer for Rebels looks great. Looks like Darth Maul is a force to be reckoned with in this next season. I see that Ezra and Kanan have brand new character designs.
Don't go too much in depth into TV stuff.
Cause yeah, we really but the TV stuff. The main question that was asked was whether there was a crossover between Rebels and Rogue One. Was, you know, there might be. You know what I mean? There might be. And that's all we got.
Well, I thought Forrest Whitaker's character...
Well, he's not in Rebels. He's in Clone Wars.
Yeah, but I guess that was... I thought that would have been the closest thing
that, to a yeah, crossover. Probably. Probably the closest thing, but Rebels is a very different animal to Clone Wars, if that makes sense. It's not, you know, it's similar, but not the same kind of thing, different kind of feeling. I mean, like, Clone Wars very much feels like the prequels era kind of thing, whereas Rebels just has that OT vibe about it. It was designed to, you know what I mean? It was designed to have that nostalgic feel. But I do like how they touch down on the prequels in Rebels and don't disown it. You know what I mean? Like, they showed a trailer of Rebels where it had battle droids from the prequels and stuff. I don't know what's going on there, but it looked amazing, man. But yeah, movie-wise, they announced the new Han Solo as well there. They actually said, what's his name? Forgotten his name now.
Oh, right.
Alden Etheridge. Alden Etheridge?
Yeah, I guess that's it.
I guess that. I can't pronounce his name, but Yeah, they announced Aldo Nurich is the new Han Solo, the kid that was in Hail Caesar and Stoker. Yeah, well, like I said before, I can't imagine anyone as Han Solo, so they must have picked him for a reason. Until I see a trailer, yay. But, you know, it's been speculation for a while. We've mentioned it on the podcast and stuff, but they brought him on stage. They mentioned he was there. John Boyega cracked a joke at his expense, going, "Oh my God, you get to play Han Solo. You're Han Solo." And then the guy cracked a smile and goes, "Well, you got Han Solo smile." And just, you know, that, you know, the crowd was laughing. John Boyega's like well beloved there, man. Like, totally. I mean, like, him and Daisy Ridley were there. I wasn't there for that panel, the Ep 8 panel, so I don't know exactly what went on there,
mm-hmm.
to what extent. I'm sure I'll find out in the next couple of days when I speak to Neil, as well as like online and stuff. I'm sure there'll be videos and stuff about it. But I saw him at a far distance. They were talking to if people don't know, there's actually a Star Wars show, the Star Wars show, which is on StarWars.com. It's been it started being a once a week thing, but lately it's been like an everyday thing with the upcoming news towards Celebration. But I know I was in the audience or the crowd, looking at them film Daisy Ridley and John Boyega in an interview aboard the Millennium Falcon set that they had there, which unfortunately I didn't get to check out because like it was just far too crowded. But they had like the chess set, and they had like, you know, looked like you could go into the cockpit area kind of thing, and the corridors and stuff. So that looked cool. They had loads of stuff there, man. They had an AT-AT Walker. They had a TIE Fighter, one from Force Awakens. They had a life-size TIE Fighter. In fact, that thing was huge. They had loads of stuff, man. It was really good. It was a really good experience. Other movie stuff they had there. That's about it, really. They had a lot of props from Rogue One. I'll tell you the other thing about the Rogue One panel. Ben Mendelsohn, man. If people didn't know who that guy was, they definitely do now. You guys should check out the panel, because he wasn't scheduled to be on the panel. He was left out. So everyone's like, "Oh, where's Ben Mendelsohn?" And then when they announced Ben Mendelsohn to the stage.
Mendelsohn.
Is it Mendelsohn?
Mendelsohn, yeah.
Mendelsohn. Either way, him. He comes in full get up, full Grand Admiral get up with cape, everything, surrounded by a legion of stormtroopers. Like if he was going to like take over the place by dictatorship, man. He just came in like a bad man. He came in like Vader, more or less. Just came in, stormed the place, took the mic, said his piece, left, took the stormtroopers with him. It was quite something. It was quite something.
Oh, well, that sounds cool. It sounds really cool. Yeah. Well, it sounds like you had a lot to absorb over this just 24 hours. So, yeah, man.
Yeah.
I think you said, I don't know much about it, so I can't really add to what you said.
I wasn't there for the Ben Mendelsohn thing because that was part of the panel, so I wasn't there.
Didn't even know that.
But before, you know, I checked the videos before I went, because that was yesterday when that happened, and, you know, Simon was telling me about it. He was going nuts. He was like, "Oh my God, you should have been there." It was like nuts. The whole crowd was going wild and stuff, and you could feel that. You could feel that in the room, man. Everyone was fucking going Star Wars nuts, man. And what I liked about it, there was just so much Star Wars merchandise there from back in the day and stuff. I was reminiscing on they had Marvel comics and stuff there from the 70s and the 80s there being sold and stuff. It was crazy, man. I saw Dave Filoni there as well, giving an interview to Empire.com, which should hit their website online at some point, going more into Rebels, of course. But yeah, it was really good, man. It was really good. Simon met Doug Chan, who's the conceptual artist behind most of the prequel trilogy. So like Ralph McQuarrie gets a lot of prop for the original trilogy, but Doug Chan is kind of like his Padawan learner. He's kind of like his understudy over at Lucasfilm, and he kind of took over for the prequel trilogy. He didn't do all of Revenge of the Sith design work, because Ian McCraig did most of that. But both him and Ian McCraig came back for Force Awakens and all of these future Star Wars films. You'll find that Doug Chan has designed a lot of the planets for the upcoming DLC for Battlefront. So yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that game plays out. And
I hear Battlefront has a single player campaign now.
Oh, does it now?
Okay. Apparently so. Yeah.
Oh, okay, I was unaware of that.
That makes that game. I still don't like the physics of the game, but it will make the game far more interesting than it was.
Yeah. But yeah, that's all I got on Star Wars, man.
Wow, well, that's an in-depth review by Sasha Alari there, but about Star Wars Celebration, and I'll put some links up into some of the stuff that he was mentioning, but I'm sure you can find them yourself. But if not, they'll be in the description, and so have a look out for that. We're running short on time, so I'm going to run past the old but new, and we're going to go straight to films opening this week in the UK. And the first film coming out, and this will be July 15th, 2016. This will be The Killing of Tony Blair. And so basically this is a documentary by George Gallery, Stephen Fry, San van der Berg, Daniel Theroux. And it's just basically what, since Tony Blair came into office in 97 as the Prime Minister until he left, what his dealings were with his partnership with America, and basically it's judging him if he was a war criminal. In a sense, because he made backhanded deals about doing certain things with America, being in alliance with particular regimes, and if you watch the trailer, it just picks apart his time as Prime Minister, and it's quite damning. This isn't going to be something for everyone to watch, but I've put it on here just so, because it was very different from everything else that was being released this week, and so I think going with what's going on around the country at the moment, I think people will find it very interesting to see what certain people of that inner circle found out about him and are now documenting about him. And so yeah, that's it'll be one for watch, I think it'll be a pretty hard watch, but go for it if you want to watch this film. It's it'll be very informative, and also the trailer would have suggested. Satch, have you got any insight into this?
No, it sounds intriguing though. I've not seen any trailers. This is the first time I've heard about it, but definitely sounds like something I'd like to watch. I know we're not sharing it, but you know, it'd be great to.
It's a selected release film, so yeah. It'll be in something like the curtain or something.
Okay.
But yeah, it's again, it's hard watch. Okay, so on from The Killing of Tony Blair to the BFG. This is a film by Steven Spielberg. This is an adaptation of Roald Dahl's book of the same name as the BFG. And I can't really say, I don't know what else to say about it. I grew up on the BFG and reading the book. I saw the animated cartoon back in the 90s or the 80s, I believe it came out, and that was okay. But this looks like a very interesting adaptation of that book, because it still has retains the feeling of mysticism. It's a bit scary. It's a bit funny. It has all of those traits in this film, and to me, it's something that I like. Paddington. I'm going to look forward to watching, because Paddington to me is very much of what the books were like. I'm looking forward to this. Satch, what about you?
Yeah, I'm intrigued. I mean, like, the BFG, to be honest, the BFG, I don't really remember it much from school. I remember it being one of those things our teacher would read us at school, you know, kind of thing, one of those Roald Dahl books. I remember the animation, kind of, but I've forgotten the gist of the story.
Mm-hmm.
I've actually forgotten a lot of it.
That could even work well for you, because when you get to see it...
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like, you know what? It's a kid's film. It's by Steven Spielberg. I'm sure I'm going to lap this up, because this is, like, his domain.
Yeah, and he doesn't do kids' film in the way that everyone else does.
Exactly. He has a certain kind of, you know, way about doing things... as a director, and plus, this is another mocap job for him.
Yeah.
And, you know, with Tintin, he was just scratching the surface. Now he's learnt how to do this, how to do these kind of films. This is probably him, like, knocking it out of the park. I've heard really good things about this film by a lot of people that I know that have seen it.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, just all around looking forward to checking it out and seeing whether he's a big, friendly giant.
Again, that film's a PG, and it's in 3D and in 2D, and it's released on July 15th. And to the last film, Star Trek Beyond, and this is the third in the rebooted Star Trek series. This one is by Justin Lin. The director is Justin Lin this time around, as opposed to J.J. Abrams. And so in this film, in the trailers, we're getting the Fast and Furious in space, essentially. Mm-hmm. And so the trailer suggests that. And to be honest, from what the early reviews on it so far have been pretty good. So, I mean, if you're a Star Trek, if you're an old Star Trek fan or a new Star Trek fan, or you've just come into J.J. Abrams Star Trek and you're a fan of it, I'm sure it follows suit to what has gone before if you enjoyed those films. And so I think there's quite a balance to it. And so from what I can see anyway. And so, that comes out on Friday as well. Satch, what do you think?
Yeah, I think this is the one I'm definitely going to check out and watch. Really looking forward to it. I know a lot of people have not liked the trailers coming up to the release of this movies, but I personally liked every single one of them.
I like the second one.
I liked all of them. I liked the Beastie Boys one. I liked the last one that came out that, like, you and Mel didn't like, but I liked it, man. I really did. Ken and Leo liked it as well. I mean, you know.
Will either of them go watch it in the cinema?
Ken will.
Okay.
Ken will. Jerry's out on Leo.
No, he won't. I know he won't.
No, he's going to speak to Pablo, so, you know, Mr. Pilache.
What a deuce. Again, you're not really a Star Trek fan yourself, but you enjoy the J.J. Abrams.
Yeah, definitely. I like the original series, like what I've seen of them, because I thought they were funny.
Yeah, they're hilarious.
Yeah, totally. I wasn't a fan of the movie versions. I remember watching the original movie thinking, oh, I'm fucking bored. And
you mean the motion picture?
Yeah, the motion picture.
Yeah, because that is a boring film.
And you know, I saw Generations, and I thought that was fucking boring. I saw
You keep watching the bad ones.
I saw The Voyage Home, the whale one. I thought that was fucking boring. It's
fantastic, man.
I thought it was fucking boring.
Forgiving people, he doesn't know what he's talking
about. I'm sorry, I'm not educated enough to enjoy original Star Trek, quite obviously. But, what else didn't I enjoy? Nemesis?
Oh, yeah, you didn't enjoy The Wrath of Khan either.
No, I thought that was okay.
No, let's not backpedal here.
No, I'm not backpedaling. My exact quote was, I like it.
You said it was boring.
No, I did not say it was boring. I said I did not see what the hype was about.
No, I'm pretty sure you said it was boring.
No, I didn't say it was boring.
Fair enough.
And I also did say that for a person going in to that movie, I felt I needed to watch the standalone episode as well to enjoy that movie.
No, you don't. You get enough backstory from that second film. I didn't know anything about that episode until I was till the age I am now.
I know, that's just my opinion. I just felt you needed the backstory from that episode to go into the movie. Cool. But that's just me. That's fair enough.
Okay, well, Star Trek Beyond is in 3D, if you want to do that. And I think it's in 2D as well.
Don't kill me, people.
It stars Chris Pine, Zachary Quinto, Idris Elba, Sophia Batula, Zoe Saldana, Carl Urban, John Jatura, Anthony Elchin in his last role. And catch it on the July 15th. Okay, well, that's been the Zito's Game podcast. Thank you for listening. Thank you, Satch. Thank you, listeners. Thank you, and good night.